Welcome back to the USCA AC National Championships held in September of 2022. Your tournament director is Jeff Soo, who's come closer than anybody to perfecting the art of directing and playing well in a tournament at the same time. Doesn't have his wife Eileen's help this time, though, so let's see how he does. We are now the official YouTube channel of our major sponsor, the United States Croquet Association. You can find everything you want to know about croquet at the USCA, from rules to rosters to how to join, you name it. Gives me great pleasure to acknowledge Chris Barley's generous sponsorship, which allowed us to do more games at this tournament. He would ordinarily be here, but he's off being worldly in the UK this week. You're looking at the two major lawns at the Chesapeake Bay Croquet Club. The bottom is the newer one, which will have 16 courts. The top is the established 8 courts that we're going to play on this time. The total of 24 courts will allow world championships, expanded nationals, etc. Tournament manager is club member Lyle Browning, with the assistance of all the volunteers that make this kind of thing possible.
This is game one of the championship final. Jeff Soo was seated first in his block. He won that. He's your tournament director, and he's playing well, too. He's taking on Matthew Essick, the top-ranked player in the country. Matthew won his block as well, and these two will be MacRoberson's Shield teammates in November. They'll be playing on court one. Looks like Matthew won the toss. Depending on where the super shot is, there are two basic responses just outside of corner two and maximum distance on the east boundary. Chris Clark has an exhaustive discussion of this written around the time of the 2017 MacRob on clarkcroquet.com. The east boundary response makes sense here, I think, because blue is further west than you would sometimes find it in a super shot. That lengthens the shot of that ball on those east boundary balls. And now he has visions of a fifth turn triple peel.
Okay.
this is, of course, why he put that super shot out there, so that if he hit in, he'd be able to make hoop one off that super shot ball and get a three ball break going. Here's a non-croquet analogy. In ice boating, the fastest point of sail is 15 degrees off dead downwind. So the sailor who's going to win does this massive zigzag pattern on the downwind leg of the race. It goes way farther than the novice sailor who just aims for the leeward mark. These guys have no hesitation about going all over the lawn, zigzagging back and forth when it suits their needs. And they get to the hoop of choice much more efficiently than somebody who's afraid to do that. I hope there's at least one ice boater in our audience who will comment on that.
A little present for you for all the hard work you're doing.
I
Matthew primarily uses the Solomon grip when he's hitting a longer shot and needs more pace, but he started using it for these shots around the hoop. A popular leave in this case is basically a diagonal spread without the peg ball. You put your partner ball out by hoop two, and you give your back ball a rush on the opponent ball on the east boundary. But Matthew's going to do what's called three ducks. Ordinarily, you would put the opponent ball between these two balls. You put all three balls on the line, so there's no double from anywhere. It makes it really easy to get a triple going, but if the opponent hits in, it's all sitting there. After this hoop shot, Jeff made a standard break through one back, and we pick him up as he's 4-2 back. I don't know whether he's doing this because he wants to blue ball at hoop two, or because he's prioritizing the break over the leave. Ordinarily, you would kick blue down to the peg at this point while you went to red. But he's going to double load three back, I guess because he doesn't like black as a pioneer. What that means, of course, that now he has at most two chances to place the peg ball. He's going to position red as in the skate ball at the peg now. And then he takes a long, hard look at blue and black because he has to decide where to put black so that he can both establish a peg ball and send the other ball to the hoop two position in a diagonal spread. Look at that. Who needs five or six chances to get that done? So in fourth turn off Matthews, three ducks leave. Jeff makes nine and sets a diagonal spread. Two in a row at 20 yards.
Thank you.
The top players all do what Matthew's doing. Nobody ever tries the massive pass roll that puts black at six and goes to red at five. Which makes me wonder why they even bother to come do the rush peel after four. You could do it just as well after five, and then that roll shot's a lot easier. But in his hands, that looked pretty easy as well. Until it wasn't. Leaving blue and black so close together means he has to get this done. It's always nice to make hoop one off partner when you're trying to set up a triple. standard practice here is to put black over on the east side of hoop four so you can rush it back down to four back and pick up yellow. But Whiteley makes the point that it doesn't really matter which side you put it on. If you're not in complete control, put it on the west side and you get the same thing done. I would guess he meant to knock Blue more down by the boundary on the approach line to penult so that he could do a nice drive shot to three back and get access to yellow. Jeff Soo knows so much more about croquet than I do that it's risky for me to try to get inside his head, but I'm going to guess that he's going to put red west of yellow, even though he'd rather have it on the other side, just because going around that hoop runs the risk of getting wired from it. The transit peels in play if you can get a good rush on yellow. Ooh, he could do an Aspinall peel and use the blue as the escape ball. He's not going to do that. Nigel Aspinall's name is attached to the stroke where you croquet yellow into the hoop and then have red on the follow-through knock yellow through the hoop. You got to have an escape ball to do that, and blue is sitting right there. everybody knows that on this takeoff, which he wants to be thin to leave yellow right in front of Rover, he has to make yellow move, wiggle, tremble, whatever. First flight, you just go for it, knowing they're not really going to call you on it. But at this level, you call a referee to watch it so you don't have to worry about it and you can focus on your stroke. I think I mentioned this in one of the Jeff's games with Kyle Malouf, but watch where he puts black. You might think he would send it all the way to Rover, but it's going to be more useful to him if it's around the peg someplace, because then he can get the proper setup on that P-Lee. And now he can start positioning escape balls for the Rover peel. Because yellow's almost in the jaws of Rover, he doesn't really need a deep escape ball. So Jeff Soo takes game one of the championship final. Matthew laid a super shot, hit in turn three, made nine, laid a three duck sleeve, which Jeff hit. He made nine, then Matthew hit in again. Got one peel done, but broke down at six. Jeff peeled his ball through six and then tripled him to finish 26-16. Give us a like, subscribe, hit that notification bell. Thanks again to Chris Barley and the USCA for their sponsorship. Games two and three shortly.